Right then, year 13, we're straight back into this. It's, my fourth podcast now. Going to be looking at motor skill learning. Okay, so we're moving on from our sports biomechanics and now looking at how we actually learn those skills. So let's start off just with a basic. So what actually is a skill? We look at these performers and we often use the word, hey, they're so skillful. Gee, that was great skill. Awesome skills. What does it actually mean? It's, well, we tend to kind of look at it and say it's how they perform a certain skill, how well it's done. Do they actually succeed in their intention of what they're trying to achieve? And how easy or how difficult do they make that action look? Skillful people, like myself, tend to make things look quite easy all the time. Now, in terms of a definition, we're probably more concerned with the operational definition of a skill. And this definition is a more kind of complete view of a skill, since it looks at the process that the performer went through in order to achieve the goal. It takes the kind of descriptive definition and asks, you know, what did the performer actually go through to learn the sequencing and timing of the subroutines in order to get such accuracy and economy of effort? Now, a couple of new words in there. Let's take a look at subroutines. Well, let's rewind a little bit first. We need to think about what's called the executive program. Okay? Now, the executive program is the overall action. Okay? So, executive program is the overall action. Whereas, when we talk about subroutines, we're talking about the actual individual movement parts. So, think of driving a car as the executive program. The individual subroutines would be things like changing gear, steering, checking your mirrors, accelerating, braking. They're subroutines that make up the executive program of driving. Have you got that? It's pretty straightforward. Now, the executive program has a number of important features. They give overall direction to the movement. They order the subroutine sequence. And it acts as the overall goal. Whereas the associated subroutines, Their features tend to be things like they're the fixed parts that make up the skill, and they follow a kind of set order for that particular skill. And a little bit like force summation, if you remember that, we must get these subroutines in the right sequence and in the right order to perform the overall executive program. If we're doing things, for example, in a manual car, trying to change gear without first putting down the clutch, we're going to have a few tears. Well, I hope you won't cry. But basically, we always engage the clutch before we change gear. If we don't, we get that nice sound effects sound as we crunch through the gears. Okay, so it's important we get the subroutines in order. Okay, something you Kiwis don't do is actually indicate before you turn. I've noticed that. You change lanes, you turn the steering wheel, and as you move, you then indicate. Whoa. Okay, good driving. Indicate first, 3 second rule. Indicate, 3 seconds, and then turn the steering wheel. Anyway, let's not get on to driving. So, driving, hey, that links us into golf. But let's talk about chipping. That's what we've been looking at recently, isn't it? Chipping the ball. So the overall executive program is the chip shot. That's the executive program. But we can break down the subroutines. Think about your grip, keeping your head down, keeping those arms nice and straight. How big is your backswing? Your foot placement, the weight transfer, the force of the swing, the follow through. So all those little subroutines all come together to make a successful executive program. Okay? But it is important that we coordinate these subroutines. If we don't, we make errors. If they don't flow, we make errors. If they're in the wrong order, we make errors. If they're not done in the right timing, we make errors. Okay? And this is where top quality athletes, sports people, okay, stand out from us amateurs in the fact that they do all this with such perfection. But how do they actually get there? Yeah, how do we actually get there? All right, and it's all to do with practice. Practice, practice, practice. Practice makes perfect, as my mum used to say. Well, she didn't actually. It was one of my teachers, I think. Or was it on a poster I read? I don't know. But you've always heard it, haven't you? Practice makes perfect. And people, no, it's perfect practice that makes perfect. So, hey, we know that we need to do something over and over again in order to improve. Now, what should we talk about? Skills. Skills, 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 and not with a Z like you horrible students write it with. Skills. Okay. Now, do you remember our internal sources in our body? Okay, we have internal sources. We have muscle receptors. We have these kind of stretch receptors in our muscles as well. We have balance organs. Remember, they're in your ears. Okay, and we have external sources: touch, sound, sight, smell, taste. Okay, so those external sources, our senses, basically, they're what are picking up all the information. And then we kind of went through this kind of information processing model. Remember on the board, we kind of drew up the three boxes. We had receptors, okay, then that went on to translators, and then effectors. And then we had that feedback loop. Alright, so we spoke about the first box, the receptors. That's your senses, that's your sight, your sound. You listen, you see something. The middle box, the translator, that's your central nervous system. So your brain, your spinal column there, okay, spinal cord, basically going out to the nerve endings in your muscles. And then we have the effectors, which are the muscles themselves. I gave you that great example of picking up a hot pan on the stove. You go to grab it, straight away, bang, it's instant. Okay, instant. Something has told you that is really hot and you are burning. And you need to put it down right now. But you don't think about it for kind of 2-3 seconds. It's on, off, bang, instant. So, we have this feedback system going on constantly in our body. Now, we can basically react to a numerous stimuli. Okay? Now, a stimuli or stimulus, stimuli plural, is anything that we kind of see, hear, feel. Okay? So, all these senses that we have around us, and you'll see it really, really well in invasion games. Things like netball, rugby, basketball. People having to constantly change direction and speed and movement and position depending on other people around them or weather conditions or where the ball is or where the referee is or where the try line is or where the sideline is. All these things going on, and players are aware of these stimulus the whole time that they move. Let's take a look now at how do we classify these skills. Think back to your level 1, level 2. We did that very basic stuff of open and closed. Do you remember that? Open and closed skills. So an open skill is one that there's loads of different environmental factors, loads of different variables that affect how that skill is performed. Think about tackling in rugby. Okay, so we've got the movement of the player, we've got the ball position, we've got the speed of the player, we've got the height, the weight, your position, your mate's position, other defenders, attackers, where the try line is, where the sideline is. All those things make it a very open skill. Whereas in comparison, a closed skill, think about the free flow. Free flow. I'm rapping. The free flow shot. In basketball, the distance is always the same from the hoop. The hoop's always the same height, the ball's always the same size and shape and weight. And the people just basically do the same thing over and over and over again. Okay, they've got no defenders against them, they don't have to pass the ball, the hoop doesn't move, the ball doesn't change size, nothing. Everything remains the same. That's a very closed skill. Ten-pin bowling, very closed. When, you know, the first set of pins that come up, exactly the same every time. A break in snooker, balls in the same position every time. However, compare that to someone playing hockey, rugby, netball, cricket. Okay, lots of movement, lots of different variables, open and closed. We get continuous and discrete skills. Continuous skills, exactly how they sound. We are continuous, or they are continuous. So things like surfing, catching a wave is continuous. Snowboarding, skiing, swimming, cycling, rowing. Okay, continuous skills that just go on and on and on. No real start or stop to it. Compared with a discrete skill that has a very definite start and a definite end. Okay, so kicking a ball in rugby. We kick it, we do it, it starts, it stops. Fine and gross, remember those? They're looking at our muscle groups there. Fine skills, things like writing. Okay, writing, sewing. Okay, very delicate fine skills. Compared with gross skills, which are big muscle groups, things like, think about the scrum in rugby, okay, big muscle groups. And somewhere along that continuum, you can plot your own skill, depending on the activity that you're doing. We now need to talk about feedback. good old feedback. This is the last thing we'll do in this session before we sign off and do the next one. But feedback, lots of different types. One type is continuous, okay, constantly provided to us when we're doing the skill. So you basically get the feel of how that shot's going or that skill's been executed. We get that continuous feedback. We get terminal feedback, which is the opposite, whereas we only get the feedback at the end of the skill. So you might see whether or not, let's say bowling in cricket, or even chipping in golf, or hitting the ball in golf, where that ball finally finishes, that's your feedback. Was it a successful shot? Was it unsuccessful? Think about those pre-tests you've done, chipping into the hoops. We've got internal feedback, that comes from all our receptors within the body, so the muscles, that basically, you know, think about doing a handstand. Handstand in gymnastics, you know whether or not your legs are straight above your head just from the feel, just from those receptors. Or we can get external feedback. That comes from obviously an external source. Someone like your coach, okay, might turn around to you and say, you know, next time make sure your leg's fully extended, next time make sure you jump, next time make sure it's the other foot you take off, next time turn your body, whatever feedback they're giving you to improve your skill and your performance. That's external. We get knowledge of results, which is known as KR, knowledge of results. You basically see that. You might do 10 layups, you might get 8 in. You might do 10 chip shots into a hoop, and you basically plot where they land. Oh, anyone done that recently? Okay, and you'll basically get to see your results, and you'll get feedback from that. You can also get knowledge of performance, once again, from a coach. You'll notice how important coaches are, and this is why people make lots of money being a coach. The coach provides excellent knowledge of performance. So they might watch you chip those balls, but then turn around and say, this time, make your stance a little bit closer together. This time, alter your grip. This time, face this direction. This time, only go halfway back with your swing. So that's knowledge of performance. Get that from a good coach. We get positive feedback. Obviously, well done. That's great. Successful. Wahey. Everyone loves you. And we get negative feedback. You're crap. Oh my God, you suck. Don't. Oh, you missed that player. Whatever it is. Okay, you missed the tackle, missed the goal. Just have a kind of think about how motivational positive feedback can be. We all like praise, don't we? All like praise. You know, I like praise. Next time you see me, tell me what a great guy I am. I love that stuff. But when I give you a piece of work back and I say, that's awesome, that's a merit, or that was excellence, you feel good. Next time I see you, I might tell you you're amazing as well. Okay, but we like getting praise, and that's motivational. We don't like being told that we're not good. We don't like being told that we're the weakest member. We don't like being told that we're lazy. Okay, that's all quite hurtful, and it makes people cry, including myself. Anyway, year 13, I think that's enough for now. What we'll do is, I'll do another one actually, looking at how, just some more skill stuff basically, looking at the stages of skill learning. We'll go through that in the next one. But take care for now, it's been special, it always is. Love you loads, and I'll see you soon. Bye bye.